Welcome to this very special event for us at the School of Public Policy at SFU and for Simon Fraser University and for Vancouver. My name is Doug MacArthur. I'm the director of the School of Public Policy at Simon Fraser University. I first of all want to acknowledge and recognize that we are on the unceded traditional lands of the Tsleil-Waututh, Musqueam, and Squamish First Nations, and we very much appreciate the relationships that we in our school and the university has with the First Nations here in this area and that we do have over the years. I just want to say a word about what we're doing here. The School of Public Policy has been in existence for a little over 10 years. We're celebrating our 10th year of graduates. At the same time, the Simon Fraser University is celebrating and marking a remarkable milestone, its 50th anniversary. So we at the School of Public Policy organized a speaker series to celebrate these two combined events, and particularly the 50th anniversary of Simon Fraser University. We decided to have a speaker series that would involve and be focused on the issue of women who are innovators and leaders in public policy and the practice of public policy in relation to British Columbia and Canada as a whole. And of course, our speaker today is a very stalwart representative of that kind of contribution. If I might just say a word, just a brief word about the School of Public Policy. We offer a two-year graduate program. We have been around for since 2003. We have quickly become recognized as one of the top public policy schools at the graduate level in Canada. We graduate 30 students a year who go off, have a tremendously successful careers working in public policy. So, and many of our students are here today, and I say welcome to you all the students. I want to say welcome Mr. President, President Petter of the University, Anne Giardini, our Chancellor, and of course, welcome to our speaker, which will be more officially, more formally welcomed as we proceed. Having said that, I'm just going to call on, we have a welcome, a traditional welcome that we will take a few minutes. I'm going to call on on three people who have made themselves available, and we so much appreciate their presence here, Audrey Siegel, Skundal, and Susan. If you would come forward, and we welcome you, and thank you very much for joining us and making your time available to us.
First, let me say how grateful I am to each of you for being here, for taking the time, for taking the interest, for using your presence and your time away from so many other commitments that are probably very important as well. I am grateful to be here. I am grateful to stand here with ancestors that go back to the sunrise to say, Mitzep Quatquilum, Atanash with Matguimach Tamoch Tanawel. Aik wanish kwaluens kwanzi kwitsnala, schem tanak kwanisquich, tinitsanat humasquium, amahuai huikden, itzlin august, kthinasit lech. This is the language that my ancestors have spoken as long as we've existed, hunt meenum, downriver dialect of a language family. The translation, welcome to the traditional unceded lands of the Musqueam people. It gives me feelings of great joy to be here with you, especially Jody. my name is Clem Tanat. I am from Musqueam, and I am the granddaughter of the late Stephen and Selena August. I have, I don't normally get nervous or butterflies, but I feel, because I so profoundly respect Jody, her history, the present work you're doing, the future work we're all going to do together. I feel like, for a Seinfeld reference, for those of you who remember, I feel like worlds are colliding for me. there was a time not so long ago that because of my public stances on all kinds of issues, especially politics, that not only would I not be invited, but I wouldn't be allowed. So this is a sign of progress to me. This is a sign of forward movement. This is a sign of working together. Nuts amatst. We are one. And anybody who's seen me speak knows that I don't shy away from the truth. In fact, I run towards it, I embrace it, and I put it out there in the most gentle, loving way possible for each of us to have a chance to huaitha, to wake ourselves up, to unite so that we can be Netsamat. So on the work with the inquiry, the Murdered Missing Women Inquiry, I hold my hands up to you and say, Haitsepka, for the women who are represented, finally, hoping to find some peace. And as I said at the inquiry work that was done here, I don't mean to take away from the work that is being done, but we all know work needs to be done now too. We need work to be done now to keep the men, women, and babies safe. We know that an inquiry for the murdered and missing women can only naturally lead to more justice for all. That does include an inquiry for Gustafson, the biggest paramilitary Canadian operation in history. This is big. I don't mean to be controversial, but these are conversations that must be had, and I say it to you with an open heart and an open mind, and really from my soul, for the people who have suffered since long before 1995, but there is action that is needed there too, so I implore you, please look at that as well. I implore you, keep doing the good work that you're doing in seeking justice. As a woman, as a First Nations woman, I know you understand when we speak of the hardships and suffering we have all had to endure. And at the end of it all, we're still here. And we're powerful and we are uniting. And for me personally, many have heard me say that the work I do is for my ancestors, is with the guidance of my ancestors, and it is my ancestors that push me to bring these things up now, because justice for one is justice for all. When we have a society that is egalitarian, as our traditional societies were here in on this land, when we have sovereignty for our women, we will have sovereignty for all of our nations, and this is what I am working towards, and I am so grateful to be able to be here, and I really feel you are listening, that you do care, and we have an opportunity to move forward in a way that we never did before. This is unprecedented territory, and I'm not grateful in the sense that something is being handed to me. I'm grateful in the sense that you pushed and worked hard and have made untold sacrifices to be where you are, to continue to do the good work that you are following through with for your ancestors. And I don't know that I could ever adequately express what that means and how inspiring that is to me, because I have days where I wonder, how am I going to keep moving forward? How am I going to find ways to keep trying to open people up to connect as a human being to a human being? Because at the end of the day, what really matters is that we do connect human being to human being, and that the historical wrongs that this country is founded on are not only addressed, but our actions are taken to put things in a good way so that we can move forward together. We can move forward with, as I've said before, love and light and peace. That is what I'm working towards. But that doesn't mean that I'm afraid to have the hard conversations. So again, I say Haitsepka to you and everyone who stands with you, all of your ancestors, all of your matriarchs, all of the men who stand in support and love you, all of the people here in this room. We're so eager to hear and learn more about you, and really just to say, please just keep up your good work, and thank you for all that you have done, and I really look forward to more good work in the future. So in honor of you and your work, we, of course, would like to sing the Women's Warrior Song. And we invite you to join us, to stand, to sing, to clap. We make it interactive. Let's get this room going with some even more awesome energy. So again, Haitsepka.
Thank you very much for that welcome, and we really appreciate your time in coming here and being with us and setting the stage for a great afternoon. I want to now move on to the program. I want to say how, just a personal note, how happy and proud I am to be have worked with our guest speaker. We've known her for a long time and have worked with her, and I just consider her to be an innovator, a role model, a person, an activist, and someone whom I hold in the highest regard. So I'm really looking forward to this event. But I'm not going to say anything more. I'm going to call on, and I want to express my appreciation to Gloria Makarenko. All of you will know Gloria, so I don't need to introduce her, but just to note that Gloria is a longtime CBC broadcaster. She's been a news anchor and has all of us have watched many, many challenging times that she has been present as an anchor and doing such a highly professional job. She's now doing the Noonar show on CBC Radio, as well as other news broadcasting. We're really honored to have you, and thank you so much for coming, Gloria, and I call you forward now to begin the program.
Well, good afternoon, everyone, and I just love the fact that the plans for this event were put in motion during the election campaign, or just prior to the election campaign, in fact. So Jody Wilson-Raybould was originally invited to be part of this speaker series before her candidacy in the Vancouver Granville riding, and she was invited to speak about as a community advocate and leader among BC First Nations, as well as her insights on women involved in politics and bringing about change and issues in that matter as well. But you got a bonus. You got a justice minister. So congratulations on your foresight for that. Her CV and list of accomplishments is very, very long. So let me run through some of the highlights for you now and give you a little bit of insight into her professional experience. Jody began her legal career working as a provincial crown prosecutor in Vancouver. That was 16 years ago. And she later served as advisor on the BC Treaty Commission. And then she was elected commissioner by the chiefs of the First Nations Summit. In 2009, was elected regional chief of the BC Assembly of First Nations. She was re-elected regional chief in 2012. A lot of accomplishments right there, and a lot of stories behind those accomplishments as well. A lot of volunteer hours, though, Jody has put in. Hundreds and hundreds of volunteer hours as director for Capilano College, the Minerva Foundation for BC Women, the Nyumbalees Cultural Center, the National Center of First Nations Governance. That list, as I say, goes on and on. Now we have plenty of avenues for discussion this afternoon. I'm really looking forward to that. But it is now my pleasure to introduce Canada's Justice Minister, Jody Wilson-Raybould.
Thank you for that welcome. I first of all wanted to acknowledge the traditional territory of the Coast Salish peoples, Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh. Thank you for allowing us to speak and have these discussions today. I appreciate the welcome and the song and to Audrey, who said that she's surprised to be nervous today. I have to say, I get nervous every time I speak. But I certainly wanted to thank the university, Simon Fraser University, and the School of Public Policy. First of all, congratulations on your 50th anniversary. And thank my good friend Doug MacArthur for being persistent, and I'm very pleased to be here to be the second speaker in a three-part series on being the change, women, policy, and making a difference. Well, I look forward to saying some words and then engaging in conversation with Gloria and all of you. But let me start by saying it is an incredible privilege and an honor to have been elected as the first Member of Parliament for the great new riding of Vancouver-Granville, and certainly to have been appointed Canada's Minister of Justice and the Attorney General of Canada. An appointment that I see speaks volumes for how far our country has come and also the important work that lies ahead. So at Rideau Hall on November the 4th, I don't know if anybody was watching that day. I must say, sitting in the room and when my name was called and my portfolio announced, there was an audible gasp followed by applause. I have to say it wasn't so much in terms of a reflection on me personally, but rather the symbolism that I believe my appointment represents. That in a nation where somebody or someone who not so long ago would not have been able to vote, let alone run for office, nor be recognized legally as an Indian and a lawyer, someone against whom the law discriminates, and in some cases still does, and who fought against that law for many years, is now the principal lawyer in charge of administering that very law on behalf of that very nation and advising its government. It takes a moment to sink in. During the federal election last year, the world was watching Canada, and if they were not then, they are now. In the run-up to October the 19th, The Guardian lamented our nation's role in the world and questioned whether or not we would return to our country's best traditions. The New York Times spoke of a subtle darkening of Canadian life. It asked, did we like what our country was becoming? The answer, of course, was a resounding no. The vast majority of Canadians voted for change. All Canadians, and regardless of political affiliation, expect that their government will be respectful of the values and principles upon which our country was founded and has evolved, particularly since the Second World War, as we continue to develop the very idea, the very concept of Canada as a beacon of hope and optimism in an increasingly divided world. In the days and weeks immediately following the swearing-in of cabinet, this became very evident by the number of people who came up to myself and colleagues, and still do, for that matter, including this morning leaving my house, on the street, in stores, in restaurants, and in airports that I'm in to talk. I've heard many amazing stories. People have come up to me in tears and hugged me and expressed their passion and optimism for our country. The reaction of Canadians is incredibly empowering and incredibly uplifting, underscoring the tremendous responsibility as the reality of governing sets in. My reflections this afternoon are in three parts based on what I was asked to speak about and certainly reflective of the theme of this lecture series. First, I want to talk a bit about my upbringing, about my lived experience and perspective as an Indigenous person in this province and country, and what led me to become the Member of Parliament for Vancouver-Granville. Next, I will provide some reflections about being an Indigenous woman in Canada in politics during a time of transition and transformation. And finally, I'll conclude with some thoughts about a vision for Canada and how I see my role as the Minister of Justice and the Attorney General, and how that role will assist in meeting that vision. So taking ourselves back a little, my traditional name is Pugles, and I am incredibly proud to come from the Musqueam, Tsawwadeenuk, and Liuktha people of Northern Vancouver Island. I'm a citizen of the Waiwakai Nation, where I used to serve under or on an Indian Act Band Council. I also had the honor, as was mentioned, to be the regional chief for almost 6 years at the BC Assembly of First Nations before stepping down to pursue federal politics. I come from a matrilineal society where we have hereditary chiefs, and I know that there are some hereditary chiefs in the room today. Being matrilineal means that descent is traced through the mother and our matrilineal ancestors. Power and inheritance flows through the mother's line. Hereditary chiefs, always men, are identified from a very young age and they are groomed for leadership. My father, Himasklalilikla, is the hereditary chief of our clan, the Eagle Clan. His name means number one amongst the eagles, the chief that is always there to help. He was given that name in a potlatch, which is our traditional form of governance. We still practice our potlatch. It is here where our names are passed down or given from generation to generation. It is where laws are made, disputes settled, people married, where possessions and wealth are redistributed, and so forth. In our potlatch, the highest ranking male leaders are called Hamatsa. With rank reflected in positions and names comes considerable responsibilities and obligations. My grandmother's name was Pugledi, the highest ranking name in our clan. Her name means good host, a name that was given to my older sister Corey. At the same time, I was given my name, Pugles, which means a woman born to noble people. The names were given in a naming potlatch at Guilford Island when my sister and I, who are sitting right there, were very young. My grandmother, Pugledi, ensured that both my sister and I knew our culture, our values, the laws of our big house, and how to conduct oneself as a leader. In our system, I am Haligilasli. One of my jobs is to lead the Hamatsa, the chiefs, into the big house. The Haligilasli can be defined as one who corrects the chief's path. We show them the way. A metaphor for life and in the potlatch symbolized in our rituals where symbolically the power of the Hamatsa is tamed, tempered, then propelled. My grandmother used to joke with us that when it came to our respective roles as women and men, that women were often too busy or too important to be chiefs. It is important to remember that we are a communitarian culture, where everybody has a role to play. The roles are very different, but equally important in ensuring that the community, the society, functions as a whole. I call it balance. In fact, our whole system was and is about balance. I've come to appreciate that it is these same objectives of balance that we need to seek in all relationships, including with respect to the place of Indigenous peoples within Canada, and for that matter, our country as a whole. I'm very fortunate that for her part, my grandmother ensured I knew who I was, where I came from, and recognized the rights and responsibilities that our people have in this country. Both my grandmother and father advocated for those rights and for inclusion within a stronger Canada, and it was within this context that I was raised. When I think back, although at times I was somewhat rebellious, I never questioned my role or where I would go. I never questioned that on this path I would go to university, that I would study law, because it was just something that was already determined. My family raised me to know that I had to give something back, that things were already determined, that we all can be the change that we desire and we all have a role to play. I was expected to push the boundaries, to move the goalposts in advancing and implementing Aboriginal title and rights, to assist in correcting the power imbalance, as between Indigenous peoples and the Crown. Of course, the roots of the power imbalance go back in time to Confederation and before. It is important to understand this history, I believe, and the struggle in order to appreciate the work that needs to be undertaken today. Before Confederation, many political and military alliances were made with Indigenous peoples under the auspices of the Royal Proclamation of 1763. During the time of the proclamation, the colonial authorities recognized the power of the various Indians or tribes of Indians, or nations or tribes of Indians, and the need to treat accordingly. Some of the nations or tribes in the East indicated their assent to treaty by presenting wampum to the Crown. The wampum belt reflects an understanding that neither group will force their laws, traditions, customs, or languages on each other, but will coexist peacefully. The laws of the tribes in their canoe, in their river, symbolized by one row of purple shells, and those of the newcomers in their boat, also symbolized by a row of purple shells. While the rivers exist side by side, they will never cross. However, when the Fathers of Confederation came together in 1864 in Charlottetown and then again a year later in Quebec to lay the foundation for Canada, Indigenous peoples were not present. They were left out. This despite the early treaty making. The fact that Indigenous peoples were left out of Confederation as partners has had far-reaching implications for Canada in the intervening years. The work of reconciliation today is, in many ways, at its core about rectifying this exclusion. After Confederation, Crown policy became one of assimilation and not partnership. The most insidious of tools used to propagate this policy of assimilation was the Indian Act, imposing an alien system of governance, creating residential schools to, quote, remove the Indian from the child. Rather than being citizens or members of a nation or tribe of Indians based on the original treaty relationship, as symbolized by the wampum belt, under the Indian Act, the Indian was made a ward of the state, the government as trustee until assimilation was complete. The local mechanism for administration of the Indian Act, along with the chief and council through the band system of government, neither an appropriate system of government for Indians, nor any peoples for that matter. This is a history that I feel, at least in part, most Canadians are becoming more familiar with, particularly given the report of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission and the publicity surrounding it, and also because of the importance, personally, of the relationship between Indigenous Canadians and other Canadians to our Prime Minister and his very public commitment that he has made to ensure and develop a new nation-to-nation relationship. Of course, considerable water has traveled down the symbolic river of the two-row wampum belt since it was originally presented. Our collective challenge now for both Indigenous peoples and the Crown, me, is to get back to the spirit and intent of the two-row wampum, while recognizing that the nature of the relationship within the modern state of Canada has changed. The laws of the nations and tribes of Indians and those of the Crown are not simply in their own canoe or boat side by side, but today they coexist together within the modern and advanced nation-state of Canada under a dynamic system that supports pluralism through multi-level governance. Let me explain. In 1982, when the Constitution was repatriated, Section 35 was included, which recognizes and affirms existing Aboriginal and treaty rights. This was incredibly significant. However, at the time, some legal advisors to the provinces played down the significance, even going as far as to advise their clients that most Aboriginal rights had been extinguished, including Aboriginal title here in British Columbia, and that any continuing Aboriginal rights were limited. Accordingly, they said, provincial governments did not need to worry about the implications of the section. For these folks, Section 35 was called an empty box that could only be populated at the will of the Crown. In other words, there was really no inherent right of self-government. The constitutional division of powers had been fully exhausted as between the federal and provincial governments in 1867, Indigenous governments not being included. For Indigenous leaders who had fought so vigorously for Section 35 and for the Charter amendments, it was, of course, anything but an empty box. The constitutional conferences on Aboriginal self-government that followed repatriation, this disconnect, in opinion, was palatable at the negotiating table. I remember in 1983, as a very, very young girl, watching the conferences at school, watching my father and many others, but my father in particular, and our Prime Minister's father, go toe-to-toe. When the negotiations were going nowhere, my father told the first Prime Minister Trudeau that, quote, there needs to be some good faith about it, and that the exercise now is not about frank and open discussion or understanding and appreciation of other people's concerns on the basis of respect and dignity. It has now become, all of a sudden, a question of power and who exercises it. Rennie Levesque, I think, summed it up best when he said later that day, quote, behind all this, what is going on is a political process. A political process that is fundamentally a question of power. One authorized spokesperson for the Aboriginal peoples has already stated the whole thing is about power. He went on to say that power has traditionally been exercised in several classic ways. Probably the most classic example is by force of arms and by strength of numbers. For example, the dispossession of the Métis during the time of Riel was a crime, which was an abuse of the force of arms backed up by strength of numbers. What alternative is there so a group can reach a civilized solution? It means accumulating enough power, enough ways of asserting pressure, so they can negotiate as equals. This is fundamental. End quote. He was, of course, right. His words were also prophetic. Since the failure of the constitutional conferences in the 80s, Indigenous peoples have been accumulating power. Economic, legal, and political power. To negotiate as equals in order to reach, as René Levesque said, a civilized solution. Today, after numerous challenges, the courts have confirmed that Indigenous peoples do have an inherent right of self-government, and that the powers survived Confederation. According to the court, these powers are, quote, one of the unwritten, underlied values of the Constitution outside the powers distributed to Parliament and the legislatures in 1867, end quote. While these powers are certainly not absolute, they do in fact exist. Today, reconciliation is now possible because of Section 35 not being an empty box. The table has been set. A couple of years ago, one of the most important decisions that speaks to this table and to reconciliation was handed down by the Supreme Court of Canada in Chilcotin. Many called the decision a game changer. I think I was one of them. This was primarily because the court, in granting the first declaration of Aboriginal title, found that Aboriginal title is territorial in nature and not simply small spots. For me, what was equally important about the case was how the bench, having decided or made up its mind on the extent of the proven title area, moved on to the next big question that needs to be answered, namely, whose laws apply to the title lands so proven and how will they be governed? The answer is multi-level governance. It will be a combination of laws reflecting the constitutional division of powers and the rules of cooperative federalism as they are evolving. It will be a combination of Indigenous law reflecting Indigenous legal traditions, provincial law, and federal law. The relationship between laws will have to be addressed through discussions and negotiations among the parties, and if necessary, adjudicated in courts. In much of the same way, this already happens between provincial and federal governments. This is significant. For me, achieving better balance in power and power sharing as between all levels of government, including Indigenous governments, is important. It helps to ensure fewer legal gaps and promotes greater cooperation and compromise. It also allows for creative shifts in the role of law in making social progress and developing and implementing innovative policy. Overall, this results in better laws, better decisions, and indeed better government. Over the last 30 years, at the same time as Aboriginal title and rights have been crystallizing in the courts, many Indigenous communities have been rebuilding, developing their own institutions of government post-Indian Act. At the local level, others regional and sometimes national in scope. Some as a result of modern treaty making in order to move through what I have called the post-colonial door. Those communities that have opened the door and are moving through it and beyond the Indian Act in whole or in part are doing better socially and economically than those that have not. In fact, I became involved in First Nations politics and ran for regional chief because I believe that by building on success, we could do more to accelerate the transition of Indigenous communities from a colonial to a post-colonial world to finish the unfinished business of Confederation. During my time as regional chief, I also came to have a greater appreciation that First Nations could not get their work done without willing federal and provincial partners. There being a need for legislative tools and other mechanisms to support governance reform, transition, and the process of reconciliation. As the late Nelson Mandela taught us, beyond necessary apologies and beyond the emotional and necessary work of truth-telling and healing, reconciliation actually requires laws to change and policies to be rewritten. So, making the jump to federal politics was not an easy one for me, nor a decision I took lightly. I cannot claim to have had a long-standing ambition to be a member of parliament, let alone a minister of the crown. But then I met a guy named Justin Trudeau. I met him for the first time about 2.5 years ago when he came up to the AFN assembly in Whitehorse. He attended one of our working sessions, a session that I happened to be chairing, where we were dealing with very difficult and controversial issues, and yes, we don't get along all the time. After the session, Justin and I sat down and we chatted. We talked about Canada and the future of Canada, about our respective visions, about making Canada even better. We talked about what we shared in common, including talking about walking in the footsteps of our political fathers, certainly his father being a little more well-known than mine. Justin eventually asked me if I would consider running for his team, and I said I would think about it. After a few months later, he asked me if I would co-chair the 2014 Liberal Biennial Convention in Montreal, and I agreed. Tim, my husband, and I were not members of the party at the time, never been member of a political party ever. It was our first convention, but what we saw was excitement. We saw hope, and in the delegates present, we saw a reflection of the Canada that we believe in. I decided to run shortly thereafter. I sought out the nomination in Vancouver Granville for a number of reasons. Of course, I live there. I worked most of my life in and around Vancouver, and I was born in the riding. Our riding is incredibly diverse, both across the traditional political spectrum, but as well in terms of the diversity of the communities that comprise it. Vancouver Granville is also a new riding, so there was no incumbent, and of course, with hard work, it was possible to be won. The campaign was incredibly exciting, long, but rewarding, and I had a great team. Certainly, I'd be happy to speak more about the campaign in questions, but this brings me to the next subject I want to talk about. Gender balance and the role of women in ensuring good governance based on my own lived experience and generally. Traditionally, in Indigenous societies, there were distinct roles and social roles for men and women, political and social roles. This was impacted by the colonial experience. Indigenous peoples being subjected to the Indian Act, and for women, this was particularly hard. The Indian Act turned our social and political systems on their head, often shifting the balance of power between men and women. For example, there was no regard for matrilineal systems. Further, the Indian Act sought to eradicate hereditary leadership structures, and in doing so, the mechanisms in place where women played a central role in the raising and teaching of leaders. To add insult to injury, under the Indian Act, only men could run for chief and council and vote in them. Also, if a woman married a non-Aboriginal, she lost her status. This meant not only being precluded from the participation in the governing process, but also losing any property. In a matrilineal society where property descends down to the female line, this is devastating. Women did not get the right to vote, or the right to run and vote for chief and council in banned elections until 1951. And it was not until 1960 that all Indigenous people were given the right to vote in Canada. What is so powerful today and encouraging is the demonstrated resilience of Indigenous women and the role that they are playing in the transition during the period of First Nations governance reform and rebuilding. However, having observed this, there are still only 25% of women who are Indian Act chiefs, although the percentage of women councillors are higher. Many more women are running, but they are not necessarily winning. And there has never been a national chief that is a woman, although again, many have run. Within our democratic institutions more generally in Canada, there is also a need for more women in politics as well as around the boardrooms. Of course, everyone is aware of our Prime Minister's now famous, because it's 2015 line, in his response to why a gender balanced cabinet. Nevertheless, the percentage of women MPs is still only 26% after the last election, and is still below the 30% watermark that the United Nations suggests results in shifts in policy and the practices of government. However, I think with gender parity in the cabinet, this will make a difference. There are steps that we can take in terms of institutional design to support the participation of women and other groups in public life. In Indigenous institutions, the role of different groups, typically the elders, women, and young people, are often built in. Self-governing tribes often make room for different groups in contemporary governance structures. Nationally, over the coming months and years, there is going to be a critical conversation in this country about democratic reform as we move beyond the first-past-the-post system. The types of reform we consider and what we ultimately decide could have, I hope will have, an impact on the number of women and the diversity in Parliament. What I can say, both as a woman and as an Indigenous person, where our rights to participate in our systems of government were denied for so many years, I place great value, as I'm sure you all do, on citizen engagement and ensuring broad and diverse participation in our political processes. So finally, I want to turn now to my role as Minister of Justice and the Attorney General of Canada. And reflect on a vision for Canada. As the minister, I am responsible for ensuring that our government's legislative and policy approaches are consistent with the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. This was made clear in my mandate letter and underscores how I am carrying out my duties. In safeguarding and upholding the Charter in all our activity as a government, I am guided by our core values and our vision. I seek to ensure that opportunity exists to engage in discussions about our public policy directions, to listen to the voices of Canadians, and to ensure that those voices are reflected in the actions of our government. This has been and must continue to be the foundation of our modern democracy. This is how we will continue to build a Canada that is inclusive and diverse, ensures equality, and makes meets the commitment of openness and transparency. It is indeed our culture of governance and our system of laws with respect for the rule of law that underpins our pluralistic society that in many ways now defines our national identity. For me, as a proud Indigenous Canadian, this evolution of our national identity is particularly poignant. It is a powerful lens through which we can understand where we have come from and, more importantly, where we are going. As a country, so critical in a global community that despite being more closely connected than any other time in world history through the ease of travel, social media, and technology, is also increasingly becoming divided along ideological lines or belief systems with less tolerance for the other. Our strength as a country is evidenced by our nation's response to the Syrian crisis. Part of our vision for our country is met by continuing to embrace immigration rooted in the concept of nation building. This is a particularly good way to view the recent Syrian refugees. Not simply our moral duty on compassionate grounds, which is reason in and of itself, but because it makes us stronger. As I watch Canadians step up to assist Syrian refugees, you cannot help but be proud. Yes, I am aware that there are those within the Aboriginal community who argue that there is still suffering and substandard conditions on reserves, and that should come first. Indeed, it is true that we cannot be the country we ultimately aspire to and want to project to the world until the plight of Indigenous peoples is addressed, and we will. At the same time, we have to play a role to support those in need who need help beyond our shores and continue to also build Canada. What we all ask and expect is that when people come here, they do not try to change others, nor feel compelled to change themselves, but rather embrace the diversity that is our strength. And where, as a result, the mix of people is the most diverse on the planet. Where what defines Canadian nationalism is not the fear of us against them, but rather where we are all us. A country based on ideas and opportunity, one not fueled by ideology and fear. It is the idea that embraces inclusiveness and creating a safe space for people to live and thrive. It is in this safe space, that is Canada, that we resolve our differences and coexist to create an economy that is one of the highest standards of living in the world. Make no mistake, societies will be judged by history by how they treat their most vulnerable. Policymakers have a role in ensuring this. In the future, countries will be most prosperous, whose economies will grow, will be those that maximize their human potential and create the environment where innovation is encouraged. Those places on our planet where human potential is incubated through good education, healthcare, supported by legal freedom, are the places where people will want to not only invest, but to live and raise a family. Secure always in the knowledge that they will be treated with fairness and never persecuted. I think this is the underlying message, oh, I know this is the underlying message that our Prime Minister and my colleagues took to Davos last week. Of course, we still have to be diligent. We cannot be naive. There are those around the world who do not like the idea of Canada and seek to fight pluralism with oppression or worse. And domestically, there will always remain elements in our society that will seek to disrupt our equilibrium. They will not be successful. Moving forward, there is no question that in my role as minister, I certainly have some well-publicized and important initiatives for which I am responsible. Often in conjunction with other members of cabinet, including physician-assisted dying, the legalization of marijuana, reforming our justice system, the National Inquiry into Murdered and Missing Indigenous Women and Girls, reviewing our overarching litigation strategy, to name a few. But if you ask me now what keeps me up at night, it is ensuring, most importantly, that we get the national balance right. Providing the legal space for inclusion and diversity so that all people can succeed if you work hard. So that we can all be confident in the knowledge that we live in a caring and compassionate society under a legal and political system that will protect us regardless of our race, our gender, our sexual orientation, or faith. This is our opportunity. Reflecting back to the Hamatsa and my role as Haligi Lasli, I think this is why I was given this job. I look forward to what we can accomplish and what we can accomplish together as Canadians. Gaela Kasla, thank you.
Some water before we start. Oh. Now, we were talking backstage a short time ago. This is your first official speech as Justice Minister, is that right?
It is my first speech. Okay, so.
You can say you remember when you were there when that was the first one. It's
and
awesome.
I have to say it is my first speech. It's not a detailed policy speech, and that speech will come, but it's as you know a reflection of who I am and how I approach my role.
No, I love the insight into your background during your talk just there, Jody, and it's been very interesting watching. Certainly from a media perspective, through this very long, long election campaign as well. I was there in Toronto as part of the national, CBC national radio team doing the radio broadcast and watching those results come in. And when we had the PEI results, first of all, in the sweep in PEI, we were wondering if our computer system had gone down or something. We're saying, a complete sweep, is this possible? And I can just imagine what an exciting night that was for you, because I was waiting on the results from Vancouver Granville, especially. I'm sure you were waiting for the results on Vancouver Granville. But that's October 19th. You've just talked about November 4th. How would you describe these past 3 months, especially? How has your life changed?
Well, I get about 4 hours of sleep at night.
Sure.
Well, I mean, in seriously, I have to say I am completely honored and proud to have been elected the MP for Vancouver Granville and followed up being the Minister of Justice. It is an incredible honor to have been asked by the Prime Minister to fill this role, and certainly I'm working very hard to achieve the balance between those two roles because I think they're important and they inform one another. But my life and the life of my husband has been incredibly, I'm going to be honest, as I always am, overwhelming. the President said, is it a whirlwind? It's been a whirlwind. And the reality is that on November the 4th, it was incredibly fantastic. The emotion and the country was reverberating. The next day, I started back-to-back 16-hour briefings and had decisions to make. So it's been fun. It's been and will, I think, continue to be overwhelming in terms of the responsibility, but we function as a cabinet, as a team. We work very collaboratively, and the approach that our team took in running in Vancouver Granville was The way that we can be successful in that work, in our work, is if we engage with as many citizens as possible to ensure that we're proceeding on the right path and that we bring that forward as my being a member of parliament and certainly as a government.
But let's take it back, because we had a little bit of a window into little Jody Wilson's world.
I was a terror, just ask my sister.
In 1982, there's this great clip, and I don't know if you've had a chance to see it, but we ran it on CBC, and I used the audio of Bill Wilson, Jody's father, up against, and he really was up against, I mean, this was face-to-face, Pierre Elliott Trudeau talking Constitution and Aboriginal rights within that Constitution, and Bill Wilson referred back to my daughters on Vancouver Island, and they tell me they want to be lawyers, and he added, and Prime Minister at that time. So how old were you then, and what do you remember about that time? I mean, it was a powerful clip, and I had a chance to talk to your father about it afterward, but what was going on in your mind?
Well, I was in grade six, and I was in my grade six class watching on television, and when I don't know if you remember, but the laughter became far more audible as they went through the series of questions where he mentioned that we're both women. But I mean, I don't remember that necessarily. I do and see it and reflect on it. But what I remember is that was a really important period of time in our history. And I don't know if my dad's watching, but my dad was a very significant political figure in Indigenous politics, certainly, and for the formation of the country in terms of sitting at those constitutional conferences, along with many other leaders that fought for and created the space that we have as a country to take advantage of and pursue opportunities. So I think that the pride that I heard in my father's voice when he was speaking about my sister and I was reflective of perhaps his thoughts around the potential that we had as a country. And I said this to somebody else on television soon after. Actually, it was Rosemary Barton. She played the clip, and she didn't tell me on television that she was going to do it. But it made me feel quite emotional. And the reality that there is a really poignant poetry to the fact that my father and other leaders sitting across from then Prime Minister Trudeau, fast forward decades to the point where I'm working with his son and so many other amazing people that we're going to finish that business. It's very powerful.
But was that, I mean, did you want to be a lawyer at that age? Was that something you had expressed? It's like, I want to be, what was that about? I mean, what were you seeing? What were you?
Well, first of all, I was really embarrassed to sit in my class and watch this, and everybody was looking at me. But I mean, for my sister and I, and for a lot of our cousins, we were told and taken. We were taken to meetings, and we were told to sit there, not say a word, but to listen and learn. And it truly was, through our upbringing, a matter of teaching. And I think that I can speak for my sister and our other relatives that we were, there were places that were predetermined. Did I think that I was, did I want to be the Prime Minister at the time? No. I think it was our father being so optimistic and thinking that I have fantastic kids and we have instilled values in them to know that if you stick to your values and the decisions that you make and you work hard, you can achieve whatever you want to achieve.
You've talked before about your relationship with your grandmother. What kinds of values did she instill, and what kind of messages have stayed with you?
Well, my grandmother, her name, Pugleti, her other name was Ethel Pearson. She passed away many, many years ago. But she, not only her, but we have a lot of aunts and people that fostered a loving environment for us, taught us our values and how to be a good person, and taught that there was that you all have a responsibility to give back. And for me, that has led me through all of the different roles that I have held. And when I have to make decisions, I ensure that they're in accordance with the values that I was raised in. The values that, even though my grandmother was feisty and was known to, you know, say a few swear words from time to time and get mad, she was very thoughtful and purposeful and taught us that you can't take your words back and that you're incredibly important, that everybody is. And
well, that's what I wanted to hit on, because there is a spirit of inclusiveness, that every voice and every opinion matters, that I've heard you speaking about her before, and just that sense of, no, we do have to hear from everyone to understand the story completely. I mean, it's an interesting message for a little girl to get from her grandma.
And I mean, I don't think I consciously thought about it at the time, mm-hmm. but now we reflect back and we think about it, but it's the nature of community, which it could be the community in Cape Mudge, the Musqueam, Tsawwadin people, or our community, our country, in that if there are people that are marginalized, that do not have free expression or the ability to move forward as individuals to maximize their potential, then our community suffers. And it is all of our responsibilities as governments, as citizens, to ensure that that doesn't happen, or to work as hard as we can to create that space.
So fast forward to UBC Law. You graduate from UBC Law, and you went to work at the Main Street Courthouse. How did that experience shape your view of the law?
Well, I articled in a medium-sized firm in Vancouver, and during my articles, I got into small claims once, and I did a chambers application, and I loved being in court. So I'm like, I'm going to be a prosecutor. So I went down to Main Street, and certainly I had familiarity with the downtown east side and the criminal justice system. And I was a prosecutor down there for almost 4 years. But I found certainly, and I know this in my role as the justice minister, that there is an overwhelming over-representation of Indigenous peoples in the criminal justice system. And that, I guess this is what I was thinking when I was a prosecutor, which led me to move beyond those years, is that people present themselves to the criminal justice system for many reasons. Certainly there are criminals that need to be punished or account for their actions, but there are also other reasons why people are there. These are issues of poverty, issues of marginalization, mental health issues, and there wasn't necessarily all of the infrastructure in place, although it was starting. There wasn't a focus on restorative justice and recognizing all of these different reasons why people come before you. So it was about, I guess, thinking about my social responsibility and doing my part to ensure that we can move towards a more restorative approach to justice, more also figuring out how we can reduce the demand of the system and prevention.
So then you go from law, I mean, the Treaty Commission, sort of that experience was really your first foray into politics in some ways. I mean, so how did that, what did you take away from that experience?
Well, it was my first foray into politics. I remember I was an advisor for 9 months, and then a position came up to run for commissioner, one of the Indigenous commissioners at the BC Treaty Commission. And I put my name forward, and I had to give my first political speech at the First Nations Summit. And I don't know if Chris or Chief Campbell, you were there, but I had written my speech. It had to be 5 minutes. I had to stick to it. And I started to give my speech, and I didn't write it down at the time, but I completely forgot what my name was and forgot where I was from. And I eventually looked over to the table and saw all of my chiefs, but it was, for me, and maybe this is reflecting on the way I was feeling at Main Street, is that we need to do our part to get involved and at the time, and certainly to this day, there's an outstanding land question in British Columbia that needs to be resolved. And it was there that I learned in more detail about the reality of the different nations in British Columbia. Certainly we have the same common experience under the Indian Act, but that there was a need for people that to work hard and to get involved and to sit down at a negotiating table and help to facilitate. And Doug MacArthur was at the Tawasin table, which is, you know, the first urban treaty, so.
Okay, and I'm moving you forward. Yeah. I'm moving you forward as we keep moving. Now, as Justice Minister, and especially as a woman in politics, and I mean, this is a relatively short amount of time to make any kind of judgmental statements or generalizations, but are there still unique challenges for women in politics today, from your view?
Well, I think I'd be untruthful if I said that there wasn't challenges. When I was the regional chief, I was the only woman for the most part of the time sitting around a table of male regional chiefs. I think that there are challenges, but I also think, and reflecting in my role now as Justice Minister in a cabinet that has parity, we're moving in the right direction. I have always thought, or I never thought of myself as different. I know I've faced some challenges as a woman, but I never really consciously think about it. I just, like most women do, work really hard and have plans and pursue them with vigor. And I think that as we continue to do that, as we continue to raise awareness and engage, and if we can put in place measures that in the transition increase parity between men and women and gain more diversity in various bodies, that ultimately that we won't be conscious about it anymore.
So. Do you think more corporations should follow the lead of Justin Trudeau and incorporate that 50% gender division on their boards, for example, and just make it a this is something we're going to do? Do you think that's a healthy way to approach it?
Well, I mean, I remember when, I mean, media such as it is,
yeah, I mean, some media.
I thought it was interesting when the Prime Minister followed through with his commitment to have gender parity in the cabinet, and then there was reports in the media or people were speaking about, oh well, they're just giving the women the positions, even if they don't have the skills and abilities, which is certainly not true from the amazing women that I know and have been fortunate to work with in cabinet. So I think that in terms of seeking to create parity in different bodies, whether they be around the boardroom table or in various positions and tables in government, I think it's important to recognize that we need to move towards parity. I believe that transitional measures are simply that, transitional, because ultimately we will get there and there will be no need for a minister, although I love Patty Haidu, a minister for the status of women or a women's council at the AFN, because we have reached that balance in our society that ensures the decisions are made well. I think we're on our way to that place.
Good. Well, I do want to open up the floor to some questions as well. So we have a couple of representatives from SFU with red t-shirts that are up at the top of the aisles there. Hold up your hands and we'll incorporate some of your questions into this discussions, because there are some big issues that you're going to be facing in the coming months and years. But let's take the pulse a little bit. We'll have to come out to the aisles if you want to speak into the microphone. So we have our first question now.
Kohwaitup, Esquest Don Morrison from the Secwepemc Nation, the Shuswap Nation, and the Southern Interior Plateau of BC. I come here speaking as a Secwepemc woman, but also as the founder and the chair for the BC Food Systems Network Working Group on Indigenous Food Sovereignty. I've worked for many decades as a teacher, as a community mobilizer, and mobilizing people around the issue of food sovereignty and looking at reclaiming and affirming our Indigenous culture. And a lot of our governance is around food, very simply and profoundly. And I also come here as an Indigenous woman who could have very easily and was this close to being one of the murdered and missing women in an experience I had on the Highway of Tears many, many years ago. So I speak with a heavy heart. My personal healing journey is deeply intertwined with my work. I, as a member of the Secwepemc Nation, when I moved home to my home territory in the year 2000 to reconnect with my people, because many of us were displaced to urban areas, and some of us have never gone home, and some of the murdered and missing women have never gone home. And because I was also on the streets in the downtown east side at 15 years old, I understand that reality. But I'm here to say that my healing journey has been a very powerful where I've come to today. And it was for, in large part, my Auntie Flora Sampson and my Uncle Jones Ignis Wolverine, two of the leaders, the elders, the Secwepemc elders who led the Gustison Lake standoff, where 70,000 rounds of ammunition were fired by the Canadian government at the camp where our elders were simply defending a sacred Sundance ground. My Uncle Wolverine is sick, very, very sick. He's an 83-year-old man, and he takes care of 50 acres on the Adams Lake Reserve by himself, almost by himself.
Excuse me, I know there's a big story there, and we were all given information
yes,
about Wolverine, about
question.
Gustison Lake coming. I would really like you to get to your question.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
That's important because as Indigenous people, we're very high context. It's hard to cut to the chase, to very facts,
I understand.
Low context.
There are a lot of people here, though, that would like to
yes,
put some questions to the
Thank
minister.
You.
Thank you.
Thank you. I guess I'm here to ask about the, you know, my Uncle Wolverine is on his deathbed, and he's asked for a national inquiry into the Gustison Lake standoff. So I'm coming here to essentially just put that out to the public and on behalf of my Uncle Wolverine, because I think it's a serious injustice in Canada. And until, yes, the Aboriginal murdered and missing women are very, very important. And I think the inquiry into that on behalf of Canada is important because I have little faith that an imperialistic government as large as Canada trying to assert jurisdiction over such a huge, diverse geographical area, that my faith is more in the discourse and in the inquiry and what can be learned from that.
Let's put that to the
Thank
minister
you.
Now. Thank you very much for your question. And it is obviously a passionate issue and certainly something that it's not the first time you've heard this either, but it's probably not the last. I mean, how do you decide your priorities and what is the likelihood of having a national inquiry into what happened at Gustison Lake?
Well, I appreciate the background, and I want to acknowledge you for telling me a bit about your story and for your healing journey that you speak about. You know, without question, the inquiry into the murdered and missing Indigenous women and girls that we're going to collectively form together is a top priority for our government. And I believe, however the inquiry unfolds, because we haven't predetermined anything, that it is a continuation or will include a lot more than simply in investigations. Certainly seeking justice for the family is fundamentally important, but will create the space, set the table for getting at root causes, talking about the colonial experience, addressing issues like poverty, lack of housing, marginalization, vulnerable people. And as the Audrey said in her opening comments, this is not about getting a report however long from now. We will get the report and there will be recommendations, but there are certainly right now steps that we can take to address some of these issues. I acknowledge Wolverine, and I'm sorry to hear that he's not doing well. Our office has received a couple of letters, certainly, on December 28th and I think last week, and I will look at that. But again, just in terms of your question around priorities, as you know, all the ministers have been given very public mandate letters, and I think that's really important. And we have a four-year mandate, but as a country, we have a mandate that's going to continue on through time. So looking at these fundamental issues, looking at the priorities that we can and must do right now, physician-assisted dying being one of them, we need to plan how we're going to address our priorities. We are going to follow through with all of our commitments over our mandate, but I think fundamentally, and this is with respect to Indigenous issues and a lot of other issues, is that we need to ensure collectively, and I know, acknowledge your comment about trust. Trust takes time to build. And the way that I believe you can best build trust is if you have open communication, that you share information, and that we, as a government, keep Canadians advised and engaged in the decisions that we're making. That takes time. I know that for myself, I'd like all of these issues to be addressed tomorrow, and I'd like to be able to tell reporters that this is the timeline for it. But we're proceeding in a comprehensive way. We're proceeding in a responsible way, and that responsibility is going to be offloaded to all Canadians to be a part of. So,
but while we are on the issue of priorities and the national inquiry into missing and murdered Indigenous women, you've heard obviously the calls this week about expanding that inquiry to include missing and murdered Indigenous men. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, we have been, and I work on this important pre-inquiry phase. The Minister of Indigenous Affairs, Carolyn Bennett, is the lead on this, and Minister Heidi and I are supportive, and we've been traveling across the country. We have pre-inquiry meetings. I just came from Quebec City 2 days ago, or Montreal yesterday, where we had one. And there are a lot of men that are in the room that are speaking about their stories, that are speaking about a missing family member. I mean, I think it's important. I think that we need to ensure that all voices are heard. What comes from or how the pre-inquiry process evolves will set the stage or frame out what the inquiry will look like. Aboriginal men and all Canadians are going to have to be and will be a part of that. I think that right now there is an incredible necessary focus on the tragedy that is apparent in the information that we have with respect to Indigenous women. Through an inquiry process, we need to actually get a real handle. This is what we've heard from families on how many other people potentially could be out there, but we're focused on ensuring that we hear from families and set parameters around what people envision in the inquiry. So we'll take it one step at a time.
The full scope of the inquiry has not yet been established. That process is underway right now.
Yeah. More questions?
Yes, Mr. Minister, I was just wondering what your reaction is to the tragedy in Saskatchewan, and if you have any words for the families.
I I think, like all people across the country and around the world, send out our deepest thoughts and prayers and condolences to the families in Saskatchewan for the tragedy and the loss. I mean, I think that's all I can really say. And to know that a nation mourns with all of the people that are impacted, that we need to do more. And I don't want to, I said that was all I can say, but I really think that we need to do and recognize that we've had losses right across the country, whether domestically or internationally. And we need to ensure that we create a society that's supportive, that we can identify individuals' challenges and seek to address them in a manner that is respectful, that looks to what is happening in different provinces and how we as a federal government can assist in that necessary work. I just, that's kind of my thoughts around what we can do and how we need to work together. But in terms of that tragedy, there's nothing that can be said other than deeply, deeply upsetting and want to acknowledge those families.
It seemed as if I did have a chance to speak with the Dene chief before we had all of the facts as the news was breaking yesterday afternoon, and he did describe what a close-knit community, how much support they had already, there was already an outpouring of support from outside of their community, but that it was already a very tight and close-knit right. community. He thought that there would be, you know, a good sort of base for healing and support within the community. It was such a tragedy when everybody awful. Knows victims, perpetrator, or alleged perpetrator. It's just a sort of sad story. Maybe you should come down the stairs a little. You don't have to come. Then the people at the back get the advantage in that sense. You can choose someone over here.
Hello, Clayton Gray. First, thank you for coming down today and thank our host. Thank you to our hosts as well. And also thank you to the traditional landowners for allowing us to gather here today. My question for you is related to Call to Action 50 off of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in creating an equity for Aboriginal people in the legal system. And I'm just wondering if you're aware of programs like Queekle's Thumb and any plans you have to create justice systems or help Indigenous communities create and restore their own systems of justice.
What was the program?
Queekle's Thumb. It's the Stolo Justice Program.
I'm not entirely familiar with it, but in terms of Recommendation 50, there's I think 13 TRC recommendations that engage the justice system and public safety. I just had the fortune of sitting down with the attorneys general from across the country and the public safety ministers in Quebec City a couple of days ago. And one of, I'm going to speak to Indigenous issues, speak to renewal of the justice system is a top priority for myself and for our government. We, at the provincial, territorial, federal meeting, we talked about the justice system. We talked about innovation, not necessarily innovation because of a lack of resources, but innovation that we can do things differently. And a lot of the innovation that we did talk about was looking and focusing more on restorative justice, which I'm assuming that this is... I should look into the program because I don't have a knowledge of it to speak intelligently about it, but there are a lot of programs that focus on different ways, Indigenous ways of assisting people that are going through the criminal justice system or the justice system generally that need to be promoted. I, in British Columbia, had a great fortune to meet with justices that are leading the downtown community court, that are leading the drug treatment court, and the Aboriginal courts that are continuing to proliferate. But I fundamentally believe in self-determination and self-government and ensuring that Indigenous communities, whether it be in the Stolo Nation, and I like that you have the moose hide on your lapel, the Stolo Nation and all of the communities in British Columbia can be provided the space to ensure that they can incorporate their traditional, their culture, their languages, their way of assisting other community members when they're having trouble is fundamental to actually ensuring that that communities can develop and thrive. It's part of nation building. I support it fundamentally as the regional chief, and I support creating and finding mechanisms, whether it's around the justice system and rehabilitation or prevention to other jurisdictions that could be drawn down. Thank you.
Yeah, I had the chance to take part in a restorative justice forum a couple of months ago that UBC had organized, and it's amazing within the First Nations communities how many there it was. Most of the speakers were First Nations leaders from Nunavut, from coastal communities as well. Yeah. But the success stories were incredible and inspiring.
Absolutely.
As well as how communities as a whole can move forward. So you see sort of more support for that type of thing then from your perspective as well, from a federal level?
I think that, and this is part of my experience in my previous roles, there is tremendous success that's happening in Indigenous communities, not only in British Columbia, but right across the country as communities take back control, create initiatives, lead initiatives to get back to that place where it's more reflective of their traditional systems of governing and balancing the current realities. I think as the Justice Minister, I'm going to continue to highlight those, and I'm going to continue to highlight them to people that can tell the story, because I believe that success begets success, and the program that this young man's talking about in Stolo, I'm sure, is replicated in other communities, but can be there can be some lessons learned from that.
Good. We'll get to you next, okay? Very
persistent. He's waving really hard.
Yeah, that's right. Please.
My name is Schmid, and I'm thankful to be on unceded Coast Salish territories. I wanted to acknowledge again Gustafson, and I want to bring up that James Pitawanakwat has received political asylum from the U.S. due to the state violence committed against the Sundancers, the Tibetan Sundancers. And I also wanted to acknowledge that the youngest warrior at Tibetan was 14 years old, and she was pregnant. And Canada gave orders for the RCMP to shoot to kill with military equipment and military support. And this is over defending and acknowledging and asserting their right to have their ceremonial grounds on their own territory. They ignored a trespass warrant. This is a very serious issue. This is something not to be pushed under a rug. There are many land struggles going on now in the province. Right now, the National Energy Board is meeting with Kinder Morgan. Is there going to be a land struggle against the pipeline? Are we going to have to worry about the RCMP? Are we going to have to worry about the military? Are you going to acknowledge that people who are trying to protect their territory are possibly endangering their lives to do so?
Well, I thank you for your comments, and I am aware of the situation and have received correspondence in that regard. And I in no way am pushing it away as not important, but certainly will give the necessary consideration. Like I said, I have received those letters, and as minister, I look at every letter. I guess acknowledging your comments about the land and the place of Indigenous people with respect to our lands and resources, I understand that. I And I know I can only speak now, and that actions are more important than words, but we've committed to action. And I look forward to ensuring that we do working jointly with Indigenous peoples, start to have that fundamental nation-to-nation relationship that is required. And that is not something that I can do or our government can do of our own accord, but it is working in partnership with Indigenous peoples to do what I talked about in my presentation, is to ensure that that space is created for Indigenous peoples to thrive. That has to do with lands and resources, that has everything to do in ensuring that the space in this country is created for Indigenous peoples to be self-governing. That has everything to do with ensuring that there is parity in terms of the investment per capita that goes into every individual in this country, regardless of whether or not you're Indigenous or not. We have a lot of work to do as a country, but I am committed to ensuring that that work continues, and that's our opportunity, and we all have a responsibility to undertake it with vigor.
Okay. Sir, right in the front here, please, the gentleman in the white, white shirt who's been very persistent.
Is that right? There you go. Oh, thank you so much for your presentation. I'm William Lindsay. I work at SFU, and Cree Nation is my background. And I've had a chance to work with some wonderful student leaders who are actually here in the audience today. And I know them and some of our other participants that have spoken up today are leaders or are heading to leadership positions much like you are in. So a question, I know leadership isn't easy. You know, I'm in such a position at SFU, and it's a hell of a job, but it's fascinating, it's multifaceted. I'm just wondering what advice you'd give to our young leaders who are here today, having walked a road that you have, what kind of qualities they should be sort of thinking about cultivating at this young point in their life so they can become effective Aboriginal leaders as they go along in their own life's path?
Oh, that's a great question.
Future leaders' advice.
Yeah. Well, first of all, I think that leadership comes in many different forms. Leadership certainly, one can be elected into a leadership position, but I think that leadership is being the best person that you can be. And knowing who you are, establishing, hey, Chief, your values. But I think about, you know, the way that my sister and I were raised, being confident in who you are, building support systems around you and people that want to challenge you and engage in dialogue and debate. Work hard. Find something that you're passionate about and pursue it endlessly. That's probably the best advice that I can give. And in my life, things have unfolded through the evolution or the unfolding of a political process. And if you work hard and you stick to your values and you look for opportunities, think maybe 12 steps ahead, opportunities will present themselves to you. And be aware and have support and just go for it. That's kind of my advice.
Could I get you to come down the stairs here, please? We've got a woman in the front who's also... Just catch my eye or one of the people in the t-shirts with the microphones if you're really wanting to ask a question. Right here, right, the blonde woman. Oh, I'm sorry. Was it you? Oh, it wasn't?
It was
Nancy. Oh, my apologies. I thought you were... It was.
I've just got a question. Do you think that the gentrification of the downtown east side is a continuation of the genocide of the Indigenous people, and such as the space that we are in right now, this campus, do you think that adds to the gentrification and the genocide?
Well, I think that we have to, again, this goes to some of the comments that I made in my speech. I think that we need to take concerted steps, and I know there's been a lot of work that's been done in the downtown east side, to recognize the challenges that people face, why people are in the downtown east side in the first place. And I will say, recognizing a lot of the comments that have come from my fortunately being able to have being able to work with some of the people in the downtown east side, is that it's a community. People take care of each other, but we need to tackle lines and divisions in society we need to eliminate lines and divisions in society. We need to ensure that everybody has the opportunity to find safe and affordable housing. That's all of our obligations as governments, propelled by citizens pushing the governments to do the right thing. But again, address root causes of poverty and why people are marginalized in the first place. Addressing addictions issues and working as a broader community, so we don't have those divisions or those lines, but that we have a community that enables people to live, to have a job if they want, and to be able to be the best person that they can be. I mean, I actually really enjoyed my work in the downtown east side. But we need to ensure that we, whether it's in housing projects where we have differing, we have rental parts and apartments that people can buy.
Yes or no?
People
are literally dying because they're being kicked out of homes.
Again, I think that we need to ensure that we provide the services that are necessary and ensure that all citizens are given that opportunity to find a safe place to live. So.
Thank you very much. It's been interesting, the data that's been collected recently about how important data is in revealing who are the people who live on the downtown east side in the first place. There are those who are being displaced because of gentrification. This has been their home for decades. But the overriding number of people that come from other communities to the downtown east side because of the concentration of social services for them here.
Right.
In many ways, it's a double-edged sword, because the push now is to have more support services in the smaller communities, so they won't feel that need to come down here. Although, because in smaller communities, if there are addiction issues or other social issues or abuse issues, sometimes that's part of escaping those issues as well. So
right.
Inevitably, they're drawn here. But if there were more support services in smaller communities, it would keep them in their communities and keep them well supported.
Yeah.
So that's what the province is looking at. We've just done a couple of forums on that very issue, in terms of making this less of a place where people are sort of drawn to, which doesn't negate the fact that there are people who do call this home and that are being pushed out of their homes.
Well, there needs to be whether it's within the province, there needs to be a broader conversation around infrastructure, around social infrastructure, and how we can best approach that, for sure.
Good. Yes.
Hello, my name's Kim, and I work for a local sex work support organization, and I'm just wondering what your intention is on revisiting the sex work laws in Canada and how you plan to engage the sex work community in a more inclusive way than potentially the last government included them, because I think a lot of people feel like their voices weren't being heard.
Well, I have said previously that we intend to look at Bill C-36 and the process of engagement hasn't been set, but I intend to, with my colleagues, to revisit that legislation to ensure that we create the opportunity to talk with people that are directly impacted sex workers, and that's going to be coming in the months ahead. So like many other pieces of legislation that I'm tasked with reviewing and ensuring that the voices of the people that are directly impacted are revisited and contribute towards amending those pieces of legislation or getting rid of them completely, potentially. That's it's an opportunity, but it's a big task, but it's an important one. So I just want to thank you for bringing it up.
Well, we're going to have to draw the conversation to a close at this point. Jody Wilson-Raybould, our pleasure to have you here. This is your soft launch into the public forum part of your of your future role.
Okay. Thank you.
I want to say some words of thank you. First of all, I want to thank Gloria for a fantastic job and for making time available and joining with us and being part of this dialogue. And I know that Gloria is a person who engages in dialogue. She's not into the gotcha politics, and these kinds of dialogues are not about gotcha politics. They are about discussion. This is one of the things I admire so much about my friend Jody, minister now. I've got to learn to start calling you minister. But she is minister. She has a huge number of problems and issues and challenges to deal with. She's bringing a new style to government. She is not engaging in gotcha politics, and she shows respect in her responses. She shows substance and thoughtfulness. I am so proud to think of Jody as a longtime friend, and I'm just so happy that you're where you are. And I want to thank you so, so much for giving us, I know your time is so challenging and difficult, and for talking so openly and frankly and being part of our conversations here as part of this speaker series and enjoying and engaging in true dialogue and opening your mind, opening us to what's going on in your mind is so important to the university and to us, and I thank you so, so much and wish you all the best. I just have a couple of more words of I want to thank and recognize chiefs and other First Nation members from the First Nations in the territory that we're on for joining us and for being part of this engagement. We look forward to further engagement with you. I want to thank all of those who supported and helped organize this, and I want to just remind everyone that we have the third in our speaker series coming up on March 15th, and Anne Giardini, the Chancellor, I think Anne's here, there she is here. The Chancellor is going to speaking to us in another one of this series. She's got a hugely interesting background, having worked in law, corporate world. She's an author, writer, an author, published author, just a fantastically interesting person. And I know that this is going to be an extremely interesting talk when she joins us on March 15th. And I hope all of you will look forward to the opportunity to come to that. So with that, I close by, if there's anybody out there who really wants a great career, come and enroll in the school. And thank you for your participation, and thank you for coming. And I have just one more thing I need to do.